This is my total worship. Anything you want. Hey guys, welcome to Kingdom Dreamers, our Friday night service. We have a lot of things in store for you guys. Amazing worship, a dynamic word from Pastor Rodney. And don't forget to like, subscribe, share, and comment. I mean, we want to hear from you guys. So now, let's get into our service.
Your word will come to pass. still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm in the palm of your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands, for you are the promise keeper. Yes, you are. And you're holding me, you're holding us in the palm of your hands. This is a confidence. You've never failed us yet. You've never failed us yet. And we never will forget how you've never failed us yet. You've never failed us yet, no. And we never will forget how you've never failed us yet. Never, 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 no, no. You never fail.
Good evening and welcome to our Friday night service. Such an honor to be able to share the word of God with you tonight. I pray that it's going to be a blessing to you. Tonight I want to share on overcoming discouragement. Overcoming discouragement. All of us at some time will face discouragement. At some time in our life we will be discouraged. Discouragement will come. People will let us down. People will treat us badly. People will lie to us. Things will not always go our way. The breakthrough may take longer than we thought. The blessing may be different from what we were expecting. Discouragement will come. And as children of God, we want to ensure that when it comes, we don't give in to it. When it comes, we are able to overcome it. Now, the word discouragement means a loss of confidence or a loss of enthusiasm. It means dispiritedness or a feeling of low spirits. Now, discouragement may not seem like a big deal, but discouragement leads to a feeling of being less confident. It leads to being less hopeful. It leads to being less optimistic. And it causes you to lose your passion, to lose your joy, to lose your enthusiasm. It causes you to doubt, to feel demoralized, to feel despondent and disheartened. It affects how you feel. It affects how you speak. It affects what you do. You may be in the job of your dreams. You train for 6 months for this position. You love what you do. You do it with joy. You do it with enthusiasm. You are passionate about it. But then, discouragement comes. Maybe you were overlooked for a promotion that you thought you deserved. Maybe they gave it to the person that did the least work in your department. And now, because you are discouraged, you don't work with the same passion. You're no longer enthusiastic to come to work. You don't give the same effort as before. It doesn't bring you the same level of joy as it once did. And slowly, slowly, discouragement begins to affect you. You become dejected. You become disheartened. You become despondent, angry, bitter, negative, complaining. Now, I'm not saying to never feel discouraged, but you don't have to let it affect you like that. You don't have to let it affect you. You don't have to let it make you angry or bitter. It doesn't have to make you disheartened or despondent. You can overcome it. You can rise above it. You can soar beyond it. You see, discouragement, if not dealt with correctly, can lead to hopelessness. It can lead to bitterness. It can lead to depression. It can even lead to suicide. And we saw this with Elijah, where in 1 Kings chapter 19, we see where Elijah became discouraged. Jezebel sent a message to Elijah that she was going to kill him. And Elijah became so discouraged that he prayed that he would die. Imagine that. This mighty man of God, the one that called down fire from heaven, the one that slayed 450 false prophets, he became suicidal. And what we see with Elijah is that the very thing that brought discouragement, it never happened. It never happened because Elijah never died. Even at the end of his life, when it was time for Elijah to be with the Lord, he didn't die. God took him up to heaven in a whirlwind. The thing that caused discouragement in Elijah's life was really nothing at all. And many times, it is the same in our lives. Many times the thing that brings us discouragement, when we look back at it, we realize that it was really nothing. The job that we were passed up for was really nothing because a better job was already on the way. The house that we didn't get approved for was really nothing because 2 weeks later, another house that was way better opened up. Many times the discouragement we face are for things that will either never happen or things that will end up being very trivial in hindsight. And we saw that with Elijah. Now, if you're feeling discouraged for some reason tonight, that is okay. Because almost every biblical character faced some sort of discouragement. We see David. He was anointed to be the next king. And 13 years went by and still he wasn't king. Instead, David ended up working for the king. He played music for the king. He fought in the king's army and David was doing good. He was giving it his best. He was doing so good that the people were singing about him. They made up a song that said Saul killed thousands and David tens of thousands. And Saul became jealous when he heard it. And his jealousy led to him wanting to kill David. And on two occasions, he threw a spear at David to kill him. And David now has to run for his life. Now, what I want you to see with Saul is that we must be careful of jealousy. We must be careful of comparison, because comparison often leads to jealousy, and jealousy often leads to murder. So David was running for his life. He gathered a small army of 600 men, and he went to Ziklag. And one day David and his men returned home, and they found their village raided and their families taken captive. And David's men were so distraught that the Bible said that they wept until they had no strength left to weep. They were so distraught that they wanted to stone David. And David becomes discouraged. Here it was, he was anointed to be the next king, but his own men wanted to stone him. He was leading them into battle after battle, but now they want to stone him. And look at what it says in 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 6. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 6. It says, "And David was greatly distressed, for the people spake of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. But," look at this, "David encouraged himself in the Lord his God." It says here, David was greatly distressed. He was discouraged. He felt like giving up. He felt bitter. He felt disheartened. But in the midst of all that David felt, and what is an example for us to follow when we also feel discouraged, when we also feel like giving up, when we feel bitter or disheartened, we should do like David did. We should encourage ourselves in the Lord our God. Do you know what the opposite of discouraged is? The opposite of discouraged is encouraged. It says here that David encouraged himself in the Lord. He did the opposite of what he was feeling. This is what David did. He turned to God. He allowed God to encourage him. He allowed God to strengthen him. David sought God. He cried out to God. He turned to God and allowed God to turn what he was feeling around. He was no longer discouraged. He was now encouraged. And if you continue reading in 1 Samuel chapter 30, you will see where David not only stirs himself back up, but he also stirs his men back up. And they attacked the Amalekites and they got back everything that was taken from them. And David went from sad and depressed to now defeating the Amalekites. He went from losing everything to now gaining it all back. He went from a position of being discouraged and greatly distressed to a position of victory and triumph. How was David able to do this? How was he able to turn things around? It's not that he wasn't discouraged. It's not that he wasn't greatly distressed. But despite how he was feeling, David turned to God. David turned to God and God strengthened him. Whatever you're feeling today, whatever you are facing, you may have lost it all. Everything may have been stolen from you. But just like David, turn to God. You may be greatly distressed. Just like David, you may be discouraged. I want to encourage you today to turn to God. Turn to God and allow him to strengthen you so that you can not just go through it, but come out victorious. This is how we overcome discouragement, by turning to God, by allowing God to strengthen us. We see in 2 Kings chapter 5 where Naaman, a commander in the Aramean army, he had leprosy. And he heard about Elijah, that Elijah could heal him. So he goes to Elijah, but Elijah does not come out to see him. Instead, Elijah sends a messenger to him to give him some instructions. And the instructions were to go to the Jordan River and dip 7 times, and he would be healed. And Naaman became furious. He became discouraged and he began doing what a lot of discouraged people do. He began complaining. He said, I thought he would come out to meet me. He would call on his God and wave his hand over me and cure me. Instead, he sends me to the Jordan to wash myself. To the Jordan. The rivers in my country are way better, he said. Why not send me to Abana or Pharpa or the rivers of Damascus? Naaman was discouraged. He was complaining and he went away angry. But luckily for Naaman, he had someone that could speak truth into his life. He had someone that could speak some sense into him. And Naaman's servant said to him, if the prophet had told you to do something great, wouldn't you have done it? Here it is, he's telling you to wash in the river and you would be cleansed. Why not try it? So Naaman listens to his servant and he dips in the Jordan 7 times and he gets cured of his leprosy. And Naaman goes from angry and discouraged to now healed and happy. All because he had someone to speak into his life. Someone to tell him the right thing. Someone to help him separate his emotions from his actions. And sometimes we need that. Sometimes we need someone to help us separate our emotions from our actions. Separate our emotions from our decisions. Sometimes we need someone to speak into our life, to tell us the right thing, to help us to see clearly. This is what Naaman's servant did. And Naaman was able to receive his healing. So I encourage you to surround yourself with people that can speak into your life. People that can speak truth to you. People that can help you to see clearly. Now, one of the hardest types of discouragement to overcome is the one that is self-inflicted. It's when you are discouraged about yourself, about your actions, about your behavior, about your thoughts. And we see this with Peter. Peter said he would never betray Jesus. He said, even if I have to die with you, Jesus, I will not deny you. And Peter, that very same day, denies Jesus. Not once, not twice, but three times. And at that moment, Peter remembers. And the Bible says he went away and he wept bitterly. And Peter becomes so discouraged that he goes back to fishing. Back to fishing. Peter wasn't even a good fisherman. He wasn't even good at fishing. When Jesus met Peter, he had fished all night and caught nothing, not even one fish. And now Peter goes back to fishing. And what is even more funny is that Peter again does not catch any fish. But what I love about Jesus is that even though Peter denied him three times, even though Peter went back to doing something that he left, Jesus still goes to him and meets him where he's at. In John chapter 21, Jesus comes to the shore as they were on their boat fishing, and he calls out to them and he says, "Friends, do you have any fish?" And they answered, "No." Still no fish. Nothing changed with Peter's fishing skills. So Jesus said to them, "Throw your net on the right side and you will find some." And they did, and they caught so many fish that they could not hold the net in. When Peter realized it was Jesus on the shore, it says that he jumps out of the boat and he swims to the shore to meet Jesus. And when he gets to the shore, Jesus does not rebuke him for denying him. Jesus does not condemn him. Instead, Jesus is on the shore waiting for him with some hot bread and fish. And just as Peter denied Jesus three times, Jesus now gives him an opportunity to confess his love for Jesus three times. And three times Jesus would ask him, "Peter, do you love me?" And Peter now goes from discouraged and sad to eager and excited. He goes from a fisherman to a fisher of men. This is what one encounter with Jesus can do. It can change your entire mood. It can change the way you feel. It can change the way you see yourself. And this is why we must encounter Jesus daily. Jesus says, "Come to me. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and he will give us rest." When you are discouraged, go to him, and he will turn it around in your life. Discouragement will come, but we don't have to give in to it. Even Jesus could have been discouraged. In John chapter 6, we see where Jesus preached a sermon, and then many of his disciples left him. They turned back. This was right after he multiplied the bread and the fish to feed 5,000. This was right after he walked on water. Yet still, most of his disciples turned back. They left him. Jesus could have been discouraged. Imagine his own disciple betrayed him. And for just 30 pieces of silver, the religious people wanted to kill him. They called him Beelzebub. They said that he had a demon. But Jesus kept focus. He kept focus on two things. He kept focus on his purpose. He had to go to the cross. And he kept focus on his Father. He said, I only do what I see my Father doing. We see the same focus with Nehemiah also. When Nehemiah was rebuilding the wall, it says that Sanballat and Tobiah ridiculed him. They said, even if a fox goes on that wall, it will fall. But Nehemiah kept focused. He focused on God. He turns to God, and in Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 4, he says, hear us, our God. In the midst of the ridicule, he turned to God. Nehemiah also focused on his purpose. He kept working. He continued with his plans, and he rebuilt that wall. And if we can do the same, if we can focus on our Heavenly Father and focus on our purpose in Him, discouragement will not have a hold on us. It may come, but it won't affect us. It may come, but we will still fulfill our purpose. It may come, but it will just draw us closer to our Heavenly Father. This is how we overcome discouragement, by focusing on our Heavenly Father and on His plan for our lives. Look at what 1 Chronicles chapter 28 verse 20 says. It says, David also said to Solomon his son, be strong and courageous and do the work. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord God, my God, is with you. And this is what the part I want to focus on here. It says, He will not fail you or forsake you. This is why we should not be discouraged. Because God will not fail us and He will not forsake us. Look at Joshua chapter 1, verse 9. It says, Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. He will be with us. This is why we don't have to get discouraged. You may be facing a giant like David. It says God will be with you. You may have a sea that you need to cross like Moses. It says God will be with you. Whatever the enemy throws at you, do not let it discourage you. Do not let it cause you to lose your passion or to lose your enthusiasm or to lose your joy or to lose your desire. Keep your focus on your Heavenly Father. Keep your focus on His plan and His purpose for your life. Turn to Him. And allow Him to strengthen you. Allow Him to strengthen you so that you will overcome discouragement. Amen. I just want to pray for every person watching tonight that you will be strengthened. So Father, I just thank you for your presence upon every person watching tonight, Lord God. That they will see that need to turn to you. Even as they face the most daunting situation, they will still turn to you and allow you to strengthen them so that they will overcome. Father, I just thank you for strengthening your people today, for being with them, for walking hand in hand with them, for making them overcomers. I thank you for doing it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
We trust that you were blessed. If you are in need of prayer, feel free to call the numbers on the screen. We are here for you. From our family to yours, be blessed.